Well, good morning, and thank you everyone for being here on this very, very special day. I'd like to welcome our friends, our media friends, our staff who's here with us, our fans, donors, and certainly friends of the program, our student athletes. In typical Gary Pinkel fashion, he told them, you better be in class. We also have two very, very special guests with us today that I'd like to recognize and have stand up. University of Missouri System President, President Mike Middleton. President Middleton, would you please stand? Thank you for all your support. And our Chancellor of the University of Missouri, Chancellor Hank Foley. Chancellor Foley, thank you for your support. Today, it is my honor to introduce Coach Pinkel. Now, Coach, wait a second, because I have a lot more to read here. I've been here now for almost 6 months, and Coach Pinkel has absolutely been tremendous in terms of the way he's welcomed me into the Mizzou family. And Coach, thank you for doing that. Thank you for making me a part of the football family. Coach Pinkel has amassed 191 career victories in 25 seasons as a head coach. That ranks second among active coaches and 19th all time. Think about that. He is one of only four head coaches to hold the distinction of being the winningest all-time coach at two institutions, Toledo and Mizzou. At Mizzou, his accomplishments include 5 division titles, 10 bowl games, and 5 10-1 seasons. Now, to put that into perspective, Mizzou had only one 10-win season in the previous 110 years. But more important than the wins, Coach Pinkel has impacted thousands of young men's lives. Mizzou has improved its NCAA graduation success rate over the last 9 years, and over the last 5 seasons, 97% of our football student athletes have graduated. You can clap for that. Gary's program has defined what it means to be Mizzou made, to develop as an athlete, as a person, to receive an education, to become a champion, and be a member of a family. As just mentioned, although his on-field accomplishments are numerous, his legacy at Mizzou will not be defined by wins and accolades, but rather the profound impact he's had on the lives of many student athletes. Never was this more evident than by the outpouring of love from his former players following the announcement of his retirement on Friday afternoon. And I received many of those just wanting me to make sure I relayed those messages to Coach Pinkel as well. And certainly, the unmistakable bond between Coach and his current players put on full display for a national audience following Saturday's emotional win over BYU. Please picture that, yes. That is a perfect picture of Gary Pinkel and his legacy. Ladies and gentlemen, please stand and join me in welcoming Coach Gary Pinkel. Thank you. Thanks. Thanks. Thank you very much. thought you were going to leave there for a minute. So I knew what was going on. So, well, first of all, I've never done this before, so you got to bear with me a little bit. I didn't have a lot of time to do it. And hopefully emotionally I can kind of keep myself in check here. And I'm very, very appreciative of you all being here. And very, very proud to be the head football coach at the University of Missouri and taking it very, very seriously. I've got a lot of calls and messages, you know, from all over the country the last 3 or 4 days, a lot of which I haven't had time to get back to friends and players from Toledo, obviously, players that I coached here in Missouri, and just really amazing coaches, and it's just been really awesome. I'm so very, very appreciative of that, you know, and that it was interesting. One thing that happened to me is we stayed Friday night in Kansas City for a game on Saturday. Got a call from Andy Hill about 9:45. He said someone wants to see you down here, and I went down to the elevator, and I walked over, and J-Mac was standing there. They were going to fly to Denver the next day. And he came up to me, he looked really sad, and he looked at me and he goes, "Coach, are you okay?" And I said, "Yeah, I'm okay." And he came over and put his arms around me and told me he loved me. And so that's kind of the neat things about this business and what you're in is that the great relationships you have with players. And I got a lot of other calls also. My high school football coach who passed away a few years ago, his name was Dick Fortner. And I, just being in this football program, I just got interested in, you know, being a high school football coach. I went to, you know, Kent State University, and that was kind of my goal. And I saw Don James came in there, you know, and tremendously successful, good man, just like Coach Fortner was. And I'm watching these guys, all these guys coach, and I'm thinking, they pay these guys to coach football. Now, does life get better than that? They would pay me to coach football. And so that's one of the reasons I like kids, and I, you know, coaching to me was, you know, I've never worked a day in my life, and that's certainly true. I think that this position, you know, being a head football coach is a lot different than just coaching a position, and that's sometimes I miss that. I miss, you know, the coaching a position, but it's, my responsibility is, obviously, I have to win football games to be able to keep my job. But I also, my responsibility is to develop young men. And I think anybody ever knows our program, it's not, I don't say that to make it sound, you know, better than what it is, but that's what we do. The way we run our program, the things that we do, I want to have an impact on their lives. So they leave, they're different people, and we help them develop them into young men. And that's, you know, really, really important. I remember when I was in Toledo and we were struggling and not winning, and I said, saying my prayers to good Lord, and it's, you know, if you don't keep me, if I don't win enough games, I can't help these kids. So I need some help here. So, you know, eventually, you win enough games, but that's what you have to do in order to help kids. And I don't think I'll ever quit coaching. You know, last night I was yelling. The Seahawks were playing, and I was yelling at the TV. My wife Missy. You know, she's called me a couch coach, and she looked at me like, yeah, you're not going to miss this, are you crazy? So she's going to have to put up with me as we do this. So, but I love coaching, and I love being a part of kids' lives, and it's really been very meaningful to me. The decision, what happened, the last couple of years, people asked me how long I want to coach, and I said I've been very blessed with health, good health, and I have my entire life. I've had great health, and I've never taken that for granted either, ever. And what happened in the end of April, beginning of May, I was diagnosed with follicular lymphoma, and it's a disease. It's a blood disease. There's no cure for it. You manage it, and that's what you do. That's pretty much what you do the rest of your life. That you manage it and deal with it. And obviously, I've read 100,000 things on it since then. I also might add to you, to this, that, and this is really important, there's people out there that have cancer and they're sick with illness that are a lot worse condition shape than I am, and certainly my prayers go out to them, okay? I think I have to recognize that's very important to know that. In May and June, I got multiple treatments. And really, honestly, for me, it felt great. Ended up being, you know, great out of those treatments and everything else. And I just plan on going to keep coaching, and I'm going to manage this and keep coaching. And that was kind of my plan all the way. Got into August a little bit when we started football, you know, started practice in August. And I just, you know, you keep, when you know you have something like this, and this just for me, it's just me, you know, the way I am, is, you know, you just start thinking about your time. You know, you're wondering about, you know, you just don't know timelines. I mean, I might live another 25 years, I don't know what can happen here. But you start thinking about your time, and then you kind of reevaluate your priorities. And so this is a little bit in August here, a little September, and then I'm going to shut this down and wait till the bye week, and I'll talk to my family about this. And I've never felt that way, ever. I mean, I've always wanted to coach the day. I love what I do for a business, but, you know, that's just really, really something that you know, was kind of weighing on me a little bit. And so what I did is I got the Monday after of our bye week, I went, and had another PET scan, and that's in this position, you live PET scan to PET scan. That's pretty much what you do, and then you adjust in treatments, adjust around those things. And I remember sitting there with Missy, my wife, and you know, all these people getting treatments and getting PET scans, and I mean, it was just really overwhelming to me. And again, I came back here, I talked with my family. And said, I just, you know, this job is, it's every day, every minute of every day. We have 127 players, you can imagine, and that's just the way the job is. And you got to give all your energy, you got to put everything into it. And, you know, we work 6-7 days a week, you know, 9 months out of the year. And is that the right way to spend my time? And so I decided at that time that I was going to embrace the healthy times, and I'm going to battle when the tough times come, and I certainly have those down the road. Prayerfully, hopefully, you know, much further away than right at this particular time. And so that's pretty much the approach that I took. When I talked to my family, and then I went in on Wednesday, and I told Mac. And the reason I told Mac Wednesday was because I love this university and the things that we did here, you know, and the progress that we made. And it's going to be very important to give him enough time to do the right things to replace me, whatever direction he goes with that. And so that's why I did it at that particular time, if you wanted to know there. So that's kind of where I was. It was kind of, you know, it was certainly undercover in terms of that. I plan to tell, you know, there's no right time to tell your staff or your players. There's no right time to do that. You know, I don't want to be a distraction, okay? So we kind of put it off a little bit. 2 weekends ago wasn't the right time. This weekend was going to be the right time, and then all of a sudden, about 5 o'clock in the evening, 3 o'clock in the afternoon on Friday, my secretary called me. They were going to walk through the indoor facility, and he said, "We just got a call that it's out there somewhere." And so then it got out, and my players, my coaches, had to be the first ones to know. They had to be the first ones to know, and so obviously I was really upset about that. And so we had a meeting scheduled right close to that, and so about 15 minutes later, I'm sitting in the meeting telling my players and coaches that I have lymphoma. All the stuff that they've had to deal with, that's about the last thing that they wanted to hear, nor I wanted to tell them. But that was, they had to know first. That was the most important thing. I think that when I talked to them, it was remarkably emotional for me. It was really, really difficult, and I knew it was going to be. I'll tell you, I'm so proud of them. All the distractions with, you know, their coach telling them they're going to leave the night before a game, for them to go out and play like they did, and compete like they did, and I was so very, very proud of all those guys and what they did. I love Mizzou. You know, I came here 15 years ago. I've never been one of the guys looking for jobs all the time. I've had coaching opportunities. I just felt we could achieve our goals here and keep making it better and better and better and keep improving. And I think we've made a lot of progress over the years. This is a great university. You know, one thing I always tell recruits is my players love going to school here. They love the place. It's a, you know, obviously it's well respected academically, but it's just a great university. Like any university in the country, we have our problems, And what you do, just like we do in our football program, you communicate, you talk, you solve problems, you get better, and the University of Missouri becomes better and better as we go. And that's our challenges, and that's what we'll do, and certainly we have great leadership to get that done. I'm proud of our football program. You know, you come here with a plan, you know, what you want to do and what you want to get done. And I felt from day one, I learned this from Don James, you run a program with honesty and integrity. And Coach James always said that anything you do, your players are going to notice. Anything you do, they're going to look at you, they're going to point to you, and they're going to see who you are. So your leadership role is very, very important. And I took that very, very seriously. I believe that I've always said you got to do the right thing. You don't make adjustments to keep players on the field. You have a disciplinary program that you do. There's consequences for bad decisions, and you adjust and you stick with it. And I felt proud to this day that we didn't keep players in even though they made mistakes. The learning experience for them was greater for the whole team than it was to try to win a football game. And I've stuck with that my entire career. When I speak, a lot of the public speaking that I do, I put a slide up and said it's all about football. It's all about people, not football. So it is. I guess I'm going to be struggling with this, aren't I? It's all about people, and it is. It is all about people. It, everything is. You know how you deal with people, and here, you know, I got much of my family here, and very appreciative of them all being here. Some of my grandkids, you know, I have 8 grandkids and 5 kids now, and just very, very fortunate to have just a wonderful family, and it's always been a priority in my life, and it's just a special, special gift for me. I look at my coaches here now. Most of them are over there. I told them all to stay over there. There's a few here, I think, but I told them over there. We had a big game this week, but what a great football staff I have. And I've always been very fortunate. And talking about people too, I've always, probably my greatest gift that I have is I'm a great judge of people. That's probably my strength. And after that, I don't know if I have anything. And the coaching staff that I've had here, the ones who were with me over the years, in the 25 years that I've been doing this, just very, very appreciative of all their efforts and what we do and what we're about here in coaching. So I'm very appreciative of them. The staff, you know, the support staff, and start saying names, I'll go through it, but I don't have enough time to do that, but certainly appreciate that. I've had 2 secretaries in 25 years, so, and a gal named Nancy and Ann here, so very, very important, because a lot of times in my business, that's the only friend you got, okay? And so you just know that at least that person's going to smile at you, and everybody else might be a little upset sometimes. I'm very appreciative of Mike Alden. Developed a great friendship, went through a lot of things together. Man with great integrity, just very, very appreciative of my friendship with him and his leadership at this university. Mac, I've gotten to know the last 6 months, heard so many great things about him, and he'll do an outstanding job here, and I'll be there supporting him 100%. Most importantly, the toughest thing about this the most important thing is my players. You know, in Toledo and here at Mizzou. I'm gonna miss that. I'm gonna miss them. I'm gonna miss their interaction, being around them, scolding them when I had to scold them, and hugging them and touching them every day. And that's what I'm gonna miss the most. Just being around the players. I was told recruits that they're Tiger for life when they come to Mizzou. Okay, so this isn't a 4 or 5 year decision. It's a lifetime decision. And I tell recruits, you're gonna have my phone, and I tell my players, you're gonna have my phone number, your phone forever, and I'm gonna have yours. You call me anytime you need me for anything. And that's certainly what I'll miss the most. This press conference, is something that I'm not a big accolade guy. I'm not into that a lot, but I'm very appreciative of you all being here. We got a big game this week. We're obviously focusing on that. We need to get that done. And we're going to try to finish this season in